¿Qué tal? My name is Jessie, and we're here at the majestic Palacio de Bellas Artes in Mexico City.
Hi, I'm Greg, and welcome to IFC UpNext, inside the Latin American and Caribbean creative industries.
We went across many countries in Latin America and the Caribbean to talk to creatives about the industry.
We're so excited to have you. Let's get started.
Vamos!
Hola, Maru.
Hoy nos vemos.
Ok.
Éxito.
Ven.
Me parece. Todas las felicidades.
Te espero.
Adi. Bienvenida.
Hola,
siéntate.
Gracias.
¿Te parece? Voy a poner
claro,
música.
Con gusto.
Gracias.
IFC has been exploring the creative industries. We've been discussing the challenges and opportunities in the space, and also talking to creatives and executives who are doing amazing work.
Yes, as you know, last November, we explored Africa's creative industries, where about 3,000 of you joined. We found out that there were areas to support the industry in the area of IP laws, financing, digital access, and also capacity building.
Yes, so just as last time, we'll discuss film, music, and fashion, but for this event, we'll also include gastronomy and gaming. The Latin American and Caribbean region, commonly known as LAC, accounts for over 14% of the world's creative exports and also 2% of the local GDP.
Yes, that's right. And in some countries, such as Brazil, the contribution of the creative industries can be as high as 10% of the GDP. So the impact of the industry in the region has been far and wide-reaching. I remember that growing up, I loved watching my favorite show, Marimar, which is a telenovela.
Nice. You can join the conversation by using the hashtag IFCUpNext or IFCNextGen on social media. So Jesse, what do we have up next?
So first up is in Colombia, which has a very vibrant music scene. Our managing director, Magda Diop, met with Grammy Award-winning artist Carlos Vives, who sung the title track of the Oscar-winning movie, Encanto.
Okay.
actually you have someone who has been influencing not only the music in Colombia, in Latin America, but throughout the world. Carlos, how did you get to that?
El trabajo me fue llevando. Y también tuve una familia que me enseñó no solamente a valorar lo que venía de la música de afuera, sino a conocer la música que tenemos en Colombia. Empezar a entender los procesos industriales de la música, nacidos de los folclores, para entonces proyectar mi música no como algo que forma parte del pasado, sino como algo que forma parte del presente. Entonces ahí ya empecé a entender lo poderoso que ha sido nuestra diversidad. Entonces una gran oportunidad, un gran universo para la creatividad, para contar historias, unir músicas. Que lo que me decían, no, es que esto no va a funcionar, es que no te vas a hacer famoso. Yo no quería ser famoso, yo quería ser útil, yo quería ser original. Y por ahí ya, sí, ya por ahí nos fuimos. Eso.
¿Cómo? Carlos, the name of your foundation, I think, tells a little bit what you've been doing. Trust la Belle.
Sí.
So it's, in a sense, you seem to be always looking for that parallel somewhere.
Yo cuando yo pensé en la fundación y gracias al apoyo de mi equipo muy especial en cabeza de Claudia Elena, mi esposa, me han enseñado mucho cómo orientar el trabajo que queremos hacer. Y así empecé como a conocer y a entender cómo se pueden buscar alianzas estratégicas para ayudar a la solución de las más fundamentales de la ciudad de Santa Marta y de la provincia, de la ciudad región. Procuramos como ciudadano, fundamentalmente como artista, buscar maneras de traerle a nuestra gente cosas buenas y trabajamos con todos.
You know, I think that you choose to stay next to your community and giving back is something that is very powerful. So, you talk about water connecting you, you talk about nature, even if you didn't say the word, I'm hearing a lot of the word nature in what you are saying. What is your relation to nature?
La música que yo empecé a cantar me gustaba por afecto, porque me enseñó gente que nunca olvidé. El afecto fue para mí importante, pero la misma música me empezó a mostrar un territorio. Empecé a entender dónde nacía la cumbia, dónde nació los vallenatos, por qué los vallenatos son hijos de la cumbia, y entender por qué Colombia lo define ríos grandes, un país anfibio. Entonces, la música me empezó a mostrar el territorio, y es la tierra de los ríos, porque cuando los ríos dejaron de ser importantes, las carreteras y los aviones y todo, olvidamos las ciudades del río. Olvidamos la cultura del río y olvidamos la cultura anfibia que está en el origen de nuestra música. La cumbia es de origen prehispánico, la cumbia es de origen chinila, indígena del río, ¿sí? Que se construye con la llegada de los hombres esclavizados, que se construye con la llegada de España, de Europa y luego con las migraciones indio-libanesas y cuando llegaron los alemanes y cuando vinieron los franceses y nos hemos llenado de historias maravillosas, pero ese territorio estaba en el olvido, está en el olvido. Y en lo personal, he pasado tanto tiempo por esa región y fue tan invisible para nosotros durante tanto tiempo. Y hoy vuelvo y digo, ojalá me dé tiempo de poder en algo, ¿sabes? Curar todas las cosas que han pasado ahí.
But you know, you brought all these, you composed songs for Encanto, and which shows the richness of the culture of Colombia, the richness of the people of Colombia. And I think that it was fantastic that you as the one who wrote your voice and composition to express that, because this is exactly what you are describing to me, that there is a lot of things that we passing by you don't see every day. And maybe we don't know what is making it blind to us. Why you are blind to it?
Para mí fue una super oportunidad conocer al equipo de Disney que querían trabajar en eso del campo y tratar de entender lo que querían hacer de comer. Y había sonidos de la colombianidad que sabían que querían que la canción lo tuviera. Uno era el vallenato, que es una música muy campesina, que es, digamos, en mis raíces. que me llevaron como a descubrir todo el universo de la música local. Y lo otro es un sutu, que es un folclore africano, que llegó al puerto de Cartagena en grabaciones francesas. Y entonces ellos querían ese sonido. Entonces me ilusiona pensar que hay gente que trabaja en esto, que necesita de esto, que observe, que empiece a pensar en el imaginario de la colombianidad. Y yo creo que sí, creo que yo escogí un camino que parecía el más difícil y he encontrado grandes oportunidades en aprovechar mi identidad y gente con un corazón como una patada.
A mí no fue para what you said is so powerful that we are from West Africa and whatever you say. And when I traveled in Colombia, but also in other parts of Latin America, you can feel how all these are interconnected. One day I said to someone, he doesn't know about the geography, he was telling me, why do you feel so close to Latin America? And I said, do you know that the north of Brazil is closer to Dakar than the cities to the south of Brazil?
Nada, que estamos conectados. Si la revolución haitiana no hubiera hecho que familias francesas emigraran al oriente de Cuba, Cuba no tendría charanga. La música mexicana hereda del sur de los Estados Unidos, el ska, que son los corridos, la polka, que está en los vallenatos de Mancho Polo Valencia. Es una cosa increíble la manera como estamos conectados todos y no. Y siempre ahí estamos creándonos fronteras y no hay límites a la locura, porque incluso nuestras historias más trágicas nos han dejado cosas increíbles en lo humano, en lo cultural, en lo musical, en la literatura, en todo, hasta las cosas más difíciles nos han dejado cosas buenas que creo que es importante aprovecharlas.
Carlos, I would like to say first big thank you to be able to be speaking from stage and to really learn so much about Colombia. Not understanding the culture of a country, the art of a country, is not understanding the country.
Sí. Yo he tenido la oportunidad de viajar por todo mi país. El talento en cada región es increíble. Entonces yo creo que tenemos que apoyar esas industrias locales, tenemos que trabajar todos para mejorar la calidad de vida de nuestros pueblos, de nuestras ciudades, y que haya esperanza, que se pueda triunfar.
Wow, what an amazing conversation. We got to see the connection between the creative industries and community impact. Thank you again, Carlos, for your time, and congrats on Encanto.
So we'll continue our exploration of the music scene in Latin America and the Caribbean through conversations and performances. From the carnival industry in Brazil to performances in Colombia to cultural ambassadorship in the Caribbean, we have our schedule packed for us, so stay tuned.
Pues comenzó hace, yo creo que un poco más de 70 años. Son muchísimas y depende de cuál espectáculo, porque hemos llegado a tener a más de 300 gentes porque se han hecho espectáculos con el mariachi, con la sinfónica, con los huastecos, con el coro, con las, entonces con los bailarines, las dos compañías, la gente de atrás, pues son muchísimos, porque es todo lo que son telones, sonido, vestuario. El vestuario que hoy se usa sigue siendo mucho tradicional. Lo que pasa es que, por ejemplo, te puedo decir que Tlacotalpan, que es un vestido muy largo, que en muchos lugares no se usa así en la tradición, aunque se usa el vestido blanco, es porque cuando ella fue a Tlacotalpan, las que montaban a caballo en la cabalgata de la Candelaria, él tapaba la parte de la cola del caballo, y entonces dijo, el vestido debe ser más largo. Entonces era, o sea, se iba inspirando así en distintas cosas que ella iba observando a través de visitar y de estar en cada región. Entonces, yo creo que la cultura es la embajadora, y así se le llamó muchos años al ballet, el embajador de México en el mundo. Pero eso ha traído a México a muchísima gente.
This is Kevin Little, and join me on IFC Up Next. I actually started in entertainment when I was about 13 years of age, really getting on stage, singing in little shows here and there in my country. I don't know if most people know, but I'm from St. Vincent and the Grenadines. That's the country I'm from. And that's where I grew up, and that's where I really started my career in music. And then in the year 2000, I actually wrote Turn Me On and another song. I was just, you know, writing songs, and it took 3.5 years to get on the charts. But yo, from 2001 to 2003, we promoted the hell out of that song. And the next year, 2004, Atlantic finally did their release in the United States of the whole album, which we did gold, and finally did platinum by the next year. The song came in as a platinum single into the United States in 2004 from sales in the UK. So, you know, it was literally 5 years of work to get Turn Me On to be a number one song, because there was no internet, there was no YouTube, there was no Facebook and Twitter. It was just MySpace. Of course, we don't have the populace like how Africa has. You know, Nigeria is probably like almost the same population as the United States. So just one nation in Africa has the population to push the type of streams that you're talking about to make a type of music, a genre, because the sales would reflect. In the Caribbean, for years, we've been struggling with the soca and the dancehall to make them a genre. I'm from St. Vincent, only 100,000 people live there. But, you know, the artists do get out there more in terms of getting themselves seen more and also reaching more people. But the main thing that we need is the establishment of our genres. And I think that that is not gonna happen until the whole region is united, kind of like how, you know, Africa is one continent, and when an artist big in Nigeria, the whole Congo, the whole, you know, Sudan, everybody is into the music, and you get all that millions upon millions of streams. And, you know, the thing is, too, Europe is a very, very open market for these genres, but you find that the African population and diaspora as well is very big in comparison to the Caribbean. Education about how the entertainment industry works is the most important thing. I think that also providing educative seminars with more established artists like myself to help the youths to know what they're getting themselves into and what to expect is a very good way to give back and help out these communities in general. Having as much jobs as possible in a community is extremely important. Extremely important. It helps to stop violence and give people something to do instead of looking to rob a bank, you know? If you look at a country like Trinidad and Tobago, because of COVID-19, the country went through a lot because they couldn't have Carnival, which is their biggest time of year, one of their highest revenue earners, not just for the country's GDP, but for the local man on the ground who only works in Carnival. That 2-3 months a year, he works, sells food at venues, does his shows, promoters, all of this. It's a really big season for Trinidad and Tobago. And for the past 2 years, they've not had it. And that really affected their community. Well, yeah, I'm working on the food delivery app, as I mentioned earlier. It's called Vonzu. It's actually in the app stores. The app is out in the app stores, but we are actually now setting up in St. Vincent and St. Lucia. We also are planning Antigua and a few of the other small islands, moving to move up to the big islands as we grow. And, you know, more music, more new music. More music is coming, so look out.
Well, my name is Belo. I was born in a small village in Haiti. At the very beginning, I just wanted to speak about things that I think that needs to be changed in my society. That's how I became an artist. So by the age of 11, I started doing music, but you know, my family did not want me to be a musician because they always say musicians are vagabonds. So, but I had to fight a deal with my mom to finish school first and then start my musical career. And it's been for the past 17 years, I've been a professional Haitian musician. I won this prize in France, from Radio France International Prize. That's how I began to start traveling, going to Africa, to, you know, different continents, and spreading the word and bring that positive image of Haiti, because my country, unfortunately, is not necessarily, when they talk about Haiti, it's always about problems. Of course we do, and I think everybody have problems, but we have other things besides problems. We are looking for a better world. I really wish that music could, and I think so, music could touch everyone and change mentalities and promote positivity. And of course, for my country, my lovely country, I want to change that negative image that people tend to have from Haiti. And I think it's not the media that's gonna do that for us. It's us, as Haitian, as artists, as, you know, as Haitian workers, we have to do that. Haitian culture is wide. When you say Haitian, what do you say? You say people coming from different countries, different regions in Africa, merging here with the Amerindian, with the French, Spanish, Americans. So when you say Haitian, when you talk about Haitian, you're talking about something big, something right. And that's what I want my music to be. If we have the minimum structure, we can do way more, because the Haitian culture is so rich. And it's not, we have a multi-genre musical platform here in Haiti. Going from the traditional music to the roots music to, you know, the alternative music to the Haitian pop music, which is a compa, going to the new generation with the raboda and the rap and everything. So we are so rich. Well, when you see me as a musician, as an artist, it's only me you see, but behind me, there's a lot of people. There's a lot of technicians, there's my family, there's family of my family, there's people who are working with me. It's a whole economy behind each artist that you see. And we are creating jobs directly and indirectly. We work with professionals, technicians, lighting, sound engineer. It's a whole market, you know?
Major parts of your artistry and your mission includes working with and uplifting local communities. So beyond entertainment, how do you think that music is impacting communities today?
And I think that's one of the things that's important right now for like our generation, you know, like with all these things happening, everybody's here, there and everywhere, you know, like stop, focus, knock them out one. You know, I myself have a whole host of other ambitions. And after 5-6 years of music, I was able to now put $30,000 into the development of Haile Selassie High School. You know what I mean? Out of pocket. You know, I'm working with the Special Olympics program now in Jamaica, and we're doing some philanthropic work that is I'm able to do now, if that makes sense. You know, so I'm always preach to youths like it's cool to do everything and it's nice to feel like you can do everything, but it's also important to focus, know what you're about, you know what I mean, define yourself in that space, and then use that definition to maximize your potential, whether earning or whatever, in the other field. You know what I mean? So it's like a formula that isn't really studied in Jamaica, because in Jamaica the talent is so important that it's like, you know, people really focus on, hey, my song or my da-da-da, when everywhere else in the world there's an industry happening. So the song is just the medium to get everything else going.
Reggae music has long been a call for social action and social justice. And this fits exactly into the work that IFC and other international organizations have been doing over the past few years. How can international organizations support musicians in Jamaica and across the Caribbean to help fight poverty and create opportunities for young people?
If you think about how many people Bob Marley has brought to Jamaica, how many people he has made buy flights, book hotel rooms, buy food, and he's not even here, right? So I'm just gonna show you the economy that we are missing out on sometimes in Jamaica by not respecting or not truly valuing what reggae music is to the wider world. Seen? So for me, where that is concerned, there's a whole lot of work that has to be done, but that work has to come from us, because reggae music start bashing the government. So when you hear people now talk about the government needs to this, and the government needs to that, no, the government no need to do not. The government just need to create the framework for creatives to be creative. Yeah? Ensure say a creative can go to the bank and him have different stipulations that is required for him to get a loan than somebody who has a 9-to-5. You know, because I mean, and these are the simple things that I'm talking about, the intricacies that, you know what I mean? Because a creative having stability, you know what I mean? Like, there are certain, these are the steps that I see that we can take to help hopefully develop a different mindset in the youth stem after we say, take it further, because that's always the duty. It's always just to take it from where them give it, take it a little further, for the youth them after we come, take it a little further. You know, the end all is never us, you know? The end all is never us, you know what I mean? So when it comes to developing an industry, those are the things that I see as key, you know?
Hola a todos, nosotros somos Azul Trabuco y los invitamos a disfrutar nuestro próximo lanzamiento titulado Nada.
Bien, si cerca estás, el mundo tiene los colores que solo tú sabes.
live from Cinepolis VIP in Santa Fe, Mexico, where our colleague Mauricio will be speaking with executives from Dynamo Production, a film production company who has been working with the biggest streamers in the world, as well as Cinepolis, who is the fourth largest theater chain in the world.
After 2 years of the pandemic slowing down production and closing theaters around the world, we're finally going to discuss the rebirth of the TV and film industry. We'll also hear insights of the current trends in the region. Should we get a seat?
Yeah.
All right, let's watch. Hola, ¿qué tal? Mi nombre es Mauricio González Lara. Soy el oficial de comunicaciones para México y región andina de IFC. Estamos en Cinepolis Samara VIP. Me acompañan Miguel Rivera, vicepresidente de programación global y contenido de Cinepolis, y también Andrés Vargas, Chief Operation Officer de Dynamo, una de las productoras de contenido pues, más exitosas de años recientes y una presencia central también en Latinoamérica. Entonces, me gustaría que empezáramos con una reflexión general en torno a eso. Este viaje de concebir la producción de narrativas audiovisuales solo como películas, ahora concebir esas mismas producciones, pero no solo como películas que se van a exhibir en una sala cinematográfica, sino que se van a exhibir en una pantalla, ya sea de televisión, en un plasma, en un teléfono, en la laptop, en el iPad. Me gustaría comenzar con eso.
Muy bien, Mauricio. A ver, yo empezaría por tal vez dar un statement un poco ambicioso. Ver una película en una pantalla grande es la máxima expresión, la mejor manera, la mejor experiencia de vivir una película. Creo que eso es algo que digamos, ha durado por décadas, digamos, desde la concepción del cine. Los cines han sido estos grandes auditorios que convocan a las masas y que, no por nada se le llama séptimo arte, etcétera, ¿no? Entonces creo que en nuestra opinión, desde el punto de vista de Cinepolis, ese va a ser siempre, la aspiración máxima, tanto para un creador como para, como la mejor experiencia para el público, para disfrutar, de una película. Ahora, creo que se juntaron muchas cosas, se juntó la pandemia, se juntó el crecimiento del streaming, de las plataformas y de repente algo que ya empezábamos a ver antes de la pandemia, una cierta disrupción en este caminito de explotación de las películas, pues empezó a acelerarse. A lo largo de todo este tiempo ha habido esas declaraciones un poco pesimistas o bastante pesimistas de que los cines van a morir. Y nosotros estamos convencidos de que no, de que la experiencia de ver una película en una sala grande y sobre todo rodeado de más gente, esta experiencia comunal, es algo que va a sobrevivir y creo que va a resurgir y va a ser tan fuerte como era antes de la pandemia.
Hoy, pues, ya hay grandes producciones latinoamericanas que han tocado Hollywood de una manera muy importante. Lo vimos en algún minuto con Roma. Lo hemos visto este año en los Oscars con, así fuera un tema animado como fue Encanto, pero pues tiene una connotación latinoamericana y tuvo un premio de la Academia. Definitivamente el talento latinoamericano está en este momento en auge y el contenido latinoamericano está creciendo.
Yo creo que Latinoamérica está en camino de, de tener un potencial de industria creativa como la que tiene hoy Corea, pero todavía estamos, todavía nos falta, ¿no? Y creo que es difícil hablar, de Latinoamérica en general. Creo que hay algunos casos específicos de países que lo están haciendo mejor. Yo creo que, por ejemplo, Colombia ha entendido muy bien el valor de los incentivos para la producción. Lo mismo República Dominicana, es otro país que creo que está entendiendo bien. Entonces, yo veo a Corea desde hace 10 años produciendo películas multimillonarias, de presupuestos de 10, 15 millones de dólares, pero eso no se dio, digamos, de la noche a la mañana. Hubo todo un entendimiento de, pues, de dejar que los grandes conglomerados coreanos, los chaeboles, pudieran hacer una cierta integración vertical, invirtieran en producción de cine. Y hoy yo creo que Corea está compitiendo con Hollywood en términos de su capacidad como industria creativa en cine, en series, en música, y creo que hacia allá deberíamos de aspirar, pero pues, tratar de entender bien cuáles son esas lecciones, ¿no?, que podemos tomar cada uno de los países. Y cómo podemos enfocar los esfuerzos hacia aprovechar este boom de industrias creativas que hoy existe, ¿no?
¿Qué deben hacer los gobiernos para apoyar las industrias creativas? Y dos, ¿cómo ven el papel que debería jugar una institución como IFC o una multilateral de desarrollo en el apoyo a estas industrias?
Bueno, Mauricio, definitivamente los gobiernos en todo esto del sector audiovisual juegan un papel muy relevante, y el involucramiento de ellos tiene que estar orientado justamente a facilitar y a generar las leyes y los incentivos adecuados para atraer esa inversión extranjera. Un poco ha pasado ejemplos como Argentina, que lo hizo en algún momento muy bien. Nosotros en Colombia se comenzó hace ya varios años con todo inicialmente con incentivos dirigidos al cine, ahora ya hoy en día hay incentivos dirigidos a todo el sector audiovisual, y pues lo que ha generado es definitivamente una atracción de inversión extranjera muy importante. Inclusive parte de la reactivación económica que sufrió el país fue gracias al sector audiovisual. Dado que, solamente para poner un ejemplo, en el 2021 existió más de 1 billón de pesos colombianos, vamos a decirlo en dólares, aproximadamente unos 200, casi 250 millones de dólares de inversión extranjera traída solamente por el sector audiovisual. Esta atracción de inversión no solamente genera, el sector audiovisual no solamente es dirigido a lo que son las industrias creativas. Básicamente, una producción mueve toda una economía, porque alrededor de una producción pues hay muchos sectores, como el sector hotelero, el sector del transporte aéreo, el transporte terrestre, temas obviamente de creativos, tema de arte, tema de alimentación, en fin, todo un ecosistema se mueve alrededor de las industrias creativas. Entonces, el que un gobierno se involucre, facilite, genere leyes que hagan que se incentive el sector, pues definitivamente trae una virtuosidad en todo el ecosistema, en donde la necesidad de crecimiento es importante, y el tener a nuestro lado instituciones que nos ayuden en generando los incentivos adecuados, generando las ayudas y inversiones adecuadas, va a facilitar obviamente el crecimiento y el posicionamiento de una industria como la nuestra, y al final de llevarnos al mundo y permitirnos llevar lo que hacemos a que sea conocido por el mundo entero. Entonces creo que también el IFC es fundamental en este proceso.
Ahora, en el caso de Cinépolis, pues sí, vemos la derrama que existe de empleos y de otras inversiones que se generan alrededor del sector de exhibición. Cuando hemos entrado a nuevos territorios, pues hay que generar nuevos proveedores, hay que contratar servicios locales. Entonces, el sector exhibición también es un motor importante dentro de las industrias creativas. Nada más por el número de gente que empleamos en cada uno de los países, pues son números no menores. Alrededor del mundo, al día de hoy, tenemos más de 27 mil empleados en los 19 países en los que estamos. Y esos son, empleos directos. Además, pues hay todos los empleos indirectos de las cadenas que están asociadas a Cinépolis, ¿no? Entonces, creo que el poder ver justamente esas oportunidades de tener condiciones favorables, creo que es el reto, ¿no? Que todos deberíamos de ver cómo se puede lograr.
Les agradezco muchísimo este vistazo general. ¿Algo que quieran agregar?
Agradecer el espacio y bueno, vamos a ver qué pasa.
Igualmente, agradecer. Creo que es una gran iniciativa por parte de IFC.
Pues muchas gracias. Muchas gracias y suerte a ambos. Gracias.
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 A writer, my mother is a writer, my brother was a writer, and I really felt like the bases were covered, and I didn't, you know what I mean? I just felt like there wasn't room for another person in my family to be a writer. And so I wanted to be a film director. But then when I had started writing, honestly, even though I really didn't want to write, it just felt like my vocation. I considered myself a screenwriter who was writing novels because he wanted to express himself creatively.
Solo he hecho producción de cine, llevo 20 años, casi. Haciendo producción, ¿no? Desde PA, coordinador de producción, gerente de unidad, productor ejecutivo, productor en línea, productor asociado. El productor es el capitán del barco, es el responsable de ahí en sus diferentes etapas o en sus diferentes jerarquías o puestos o modalidades más bien de producción. Tenemos que administrar las ideas de los estudios contra los de los directores para pues, poder sacar adelante el proyecto de la mejor manera, ¿no? Y que sean éxitos. Esto es un negocio y un presupuesto es una ingeniería. Y lo que estamos haciendo aquí es dinero. Y todo eso que nos dicen que tenemos que entregar al final viene de un estudio, de un análisis de esos estudios. Ya sabes qué actor va con qué actor y qué director va a contar esta historia y la música. Y al final de cuentas se está volviendo esta industrialización pues del cine y de la televisión.
I come from a very small town in Colombia where we didn't have access to technology as widespread as we have it today. I didn't go to college to learn animation, but I did learn in college the importance or what it meant to be a creator and a storyteller, which was very important because after I graduated, 9/11 happened and I became obsessed with media and politics, and I started trying to use the animation that I had learned and my interest in art to express what I was feeling at the time in the politics in Colombia, in the United States. That led me to create one of the first video blogs in Colombia. I got a Fulbright scholarship for the artists, and that is the reason why I ended up going to California to do a master's in animation at USC. I made a bunch of award-winning films that connected me with the industry, and I started working as a creative director, mainly trying to solve problems because I work in a division called the special projects, which means everything that comes to us, we have to invent the way we do it every single time. Colombia has so much talent, so I think that's right now one of the biggest challenges is how do we support these growing industries in a way that we become more reliable as vendors? Well, we just launched a very interesting collaboration with Hulu and a lot of independent artists from around the world, a few of them Colombian, to create station IDs. I am trying to sell a feature film, which I'm hoping can be produced or have a majority of Colombian talent in it, because I do think, like, if it's going to be a Colombian story, let's try to have as many Colombian talent, but then see if we can produce it in the way that is expected in, you know, the Hollywood industry.
I would say that diversity is incredibly important in a writer's room, and I'm not talking about any quotas of, like, inclusion or anything. It's important to have diversity, because if you have people that come from exactly the same background and have the exact same gender and everything, they are going to, even though everyone is certainly different, they're going to tend to pitch similar ideas. For example, I was in a writer's room after working on Luis Miguel. I was in a writer's room for a TV show called El Candidato, which was actually written in Los Angeles. I was the only one that had grown up in the city where the show was going to take place. Now imagine the showrunner, my boss, saying, "We don't need a Mexican writer." Well, he would have, and probably he would have hired very talented writers, but not having a Mexican on the show would have robbed the show of a certain color. The Luis Miguel room in particular was very diverse for the first season. I believe it was 50%. No, there were more women than guys in that room. So diversity is incredibly important, and I would say that there's a hunger for that. There is a hunger for stories that are local, that are written by locals. I think this has made the TV landscape way more diverse.
Personalmente, nunca me tocó una discriminación por ser mujer, pero sí tengo compañeras que sí lo han tenido y las directoras, tengo varias directoras, amigas, que pues, han sufrido eso, ¿no? Que les pagan menos porque son mujeres o que sufren algún tipo de acoso. La diversidad nos va a hacer mejores. Tenemos más de qué platicar, tenemos más horizonte. Tu horizonte es diferente al mío. ¿Por qué? Porque somos diferentes. Porque tenemos cuerpos diferentes y concepciones de la vida diferentes, porque tenemos un género diferente. Sí somos diferentes. Y eso nos hace fuertes a nivel de contenido, nos hace tener justo esta diversidad. Y la diversidad en los contenidos creativos, pues me parece que es una de las claves.
Hey everyone. Happy you tuned in to this edition of IFC UpNext, inside the Latin American and Caribbean creative industries. I am Marc Alain Boussico. I am the founder of Bunch, the biggest tech hub in Haiti. Our mission has been around bringing entrepreneurs closer to the ecosystem, leveraging technology to create startups that can help fuel a global revolution. The creative industry has been one of the sectors that we've been focusing on. Some of our most exciting projects include the Creative Tech Lab, where we have allowed creatives and technologies to come together and create prototypes that could create a difference in the ecosystem. We have actually been able to scale that in the Caribbean by taking it to the country of Trinidad and Tobago. We help entrepreneurs get access to training, but also we help them connect with each other and also leverage networking. One of our projects right now is the Creatix, where we're aiming to train 150 creatives with the latest technologies, leveraging the latest platform like TikTok, using augmented reality, virtual reality, and the power of blockchain. So as an influencer myself, it's very important that creatives understand their role in the global economy, especially after COVID-19, where content have gone viral and people are using the internet more and more. Haitians can do that too. And one of the most amazing examples is Jessica Genes. She has been able to take her movie, Frida, to the world and be able to share the Haitian story. So hey, guess who we have with you today? Jessica Genes. Join me in a casual conversation with Jessica right now. Jessica, very happy to have you here.
Happy to be with you, Mark.
So tell us how you started in film and what do you have going on right now?
Well, I started as an actress when I was 17 years old. I'm not gonna say how many years that is ago. So I played in a couple of films in Haiti. And then at some point, the industry, if we can call it like that, kind of collapsed. So I had to leave the country. It coincidenced also with the earthquake. So we had the earthquake, and right before that, all the movie theaters closed and nobody was actually producing anything. So I went to France. I studied for 3 years cinema, and then I came back home to open my production company, because it's kind of hard to be an actress, a black actress, black female actress, black Haitian female actress in France. So I had to leave and come back to my country. So I came back, opened Aizan Production, my production company, made like 20 to 25 portrait, short documentaries, made my first 52 documentaries, and then a documentary, and then I made Frida, my first feature film, yeah.
Yeah, we're gonna talk about Frida, of course, but let's step back a little bit. Tell us today, what's the industry looking like in Haiti?
Well, I think it's kind of how the population is behaving, you know, within the society. Everybody's trying to do what they can in the limitation of what they have as resources, because right now, as a human in Haiti, everything is limited for you. You cannot, you know, there's very few things that you can do. Even, you know, recreative space are almost, you know, non-existent in Port-au-Prince and outside of Haiti. You cannot leave Port-au-Prince right now. So there's a lot of social problem that, of course, affected everything. So right now, I feel like there's a few of us that are still trying, that are still making, you know. There's a documentary festival every year. There's a, you know, a theater film theater festival every year. There's different kind of, you know, small group activities everywhere. But I think where the gap is how do you transform that into money?
Yeah.
And how do you transform it into something that can generate money for people that are involved? Yeah.
That's a great point. And there's also so much to show about Haiti. Yet you made Frida, you made it to Cannes, and I guess the whole world started talking about Haiti and the movie.
And I remember on the 13th of October when I woke up in France, because the movie was about to come out in France after the Cannes Film Festival, all the headlines in France were like, Haiti mon amour, you know, Haiti my love, the women of Haiti, the strong women of Port-au-Prince. Yeah. So you had like, I have goosebumps. You had like 10 or 15 headlines.
Winning chain.
Yeah. And it was, yeah, you know, and it was all positive reviews. And I said, geez, like for me, that was as strong as the fact that the film was in the Cannes Film Festival.
Mm-hmm.
It was a great moment, you know, for us as a nation,
yeah,
to see ourselves the way we perceive ourselves, not the way, you know, journalists choose to perceive us, yeah.
But a movie like this, such exposure to the world, what do you think that does to a creative like you?
A lot. First of all, because we've never had a film with, you know, that has been shot with mostly Haitian crew, and this was crucial for me in the process. I wanted the crew to be mostly Haitian. I wanted the film to be in Creole. I wanted the film to be entirely shot in Port-au-Prince. And those were choices that were extremely hard to make.
Yeah.
Those are choices that actually stopped me from having a bunch, you know, a good part of my money to make my film. Because when you say all those aspects, people are like, oh, this film is not going anywhere.
That reminds me of what Haya was saying in a previous UpNext about, you know, defending more diversity behind the camera. Well, Jessica, thank you so much for participating in our conversation.
Yeah.
Know that we are very proud of you, and I hope that this conversation inspired many. Thank you for participating in our edition of UpNext. This is Inside the Latin America and Caribbean Creative Industries.
Thank you, Moi.
Desde hace 10 años mi vida cambió absolutamente. Yo fui actriz durante 15 años. Y por un personaje que estaba haciendo en televisión en ese momento, me invitaron a ser jurado en un evento de la cárcel de mujeres en Bogotá, El Buen Pastor. Era la primera vez que yo estaba en una cárcel. Obviamente conocía la situación de las cárceles de nuestro país, pero una cosa es verlo en medios de comunicación, noticieros, y otra muy diferente es estar ahí en el espacio físico. Tomé la decisión de retirarme de mi trabajo como actriz y dedicarme 100% a las cárceles. Y bueno, ya este año cumplimos 10 años en la Fundación Acción Interna trabajando con personas que están privadas de la libertad, con personas que han recuperado su libertad, con jóvenes privados de la libertad y con sus familias. Nosotros empezamos haciendo teatro en las cárceles y 3 meses después de ensayar todos los días en las cárceles con ellas, presentamos esta obra a toda la cárcel, a personas privadas de la libertad de todos los patios de la cárcel. Y yo estaba sentada en primera fila viendo esta obra de teatro y vi a 12 mujeres totalmente transformadas. Eran 12 mujeres muy diferentes a las que yo había conocido 3 meses antes. Eran mujeres con un brillo en sus ojos, con una motivación, con una transformación, con una esperanza de vida. Y en ese momento pensé, el teatro transforma. Quiero hacer esto afuera de la cárcel, que todo el mundo sea testigo de esa transformación y hacerlo en todas las cárceles de Colombia. Y decidimos que queríamos sacarlas a presentar en el mejor teatro, con el mejor director, con el mejor productor, con la mejor escenografía, con el mejor vestuario. Después de 8 meses logramos el permiso, la sacamos a presentarse por fuera de la cárcel. Realmente pude ser testigo de una reconciliación real. Y a raíz de eso empezamos a hacer nuestro Festival Nacional de Teatro Carcelario, en donde participan 6 cárceles a nivel nacional. Cada una monta una obra de teatro, se presenta por fuera de la cárcel. Y el ganador se viene al Iberoamericano de Bogotá a presentarse acá. Como decía, pensé que era el teatro lo que las transformaba, pero hoy, después de 10 años, sé que lo que realmente las transformó fue simplemente tener una oportunidad. La cooperación internacional ha sido clave en todos los programas de la Fundación. Han sido un gran apoyo económico. Cooperación internacional, también tenemos apoyo del sector público y privado, pero cooperación internacional creo que es de los más importantes apoyos que tenemos en la Fundación Acción Interna. Por un lado, en la parte económica, y por un lado creo que también que sea esta la oportunidad para invitarlos a que conozcan nuestro programa, a que se pueda replicar en más cárceles a nivel global. Estamos ahorita con una entidad internacional sistematizando y documentando toda nuestra metodología de intervención para que pueda ser replicada en cualquier cárcel, en cualquier país del mundo, y pues así beneficiar a muchos internos más. La Ley de Segundas Oportunidades es un gran logro después de casi un año de estar en debates, de proponer el proyecto. Fue algo muy importante para la Fundación porque tuvimos el apoyo de todas las bancadas. Todos los partidos políticos firmaron este proyecto de ley, lo apoyaron. Y bueno, ya después de un año ya pasó su cuarto debate y ya es una realidad la Ley de las Segundas Oportunidades, que es una ley para tener beneficios económicos y tributarios para empresas que contraten a pospenados, a personas que han recuperado su libertad. Y eso es maravilloso. Trabajar con esta población realmente es muy satisfactorio porque son personas que realmente saben el valor de una oportunidad, saben lo difícil que es conseguirla. Entonces, una vez la tienen, la cuidan y la protegen muchísimo.
By boosting the economy, promoting knowledge, nurturing talent, and creating purpose and inspiration for the societies, the creative industries can become a development tool for emerging nations. In Latin America and the Caribbean, the creative industries play a fundamental role in the economy of the region. But more than that, the cultural icons as diverse as Bob Marley, Shakira, Alfonso Cuarón, Carlos Vives, and Rihanna contributed hugely to the influence of Latin America and the Caribbean. Movies like Coco and Encanto have done more to improve the image of Mexico and Colombia than many orchestrated political efforts. The influences of the Mexican and Peruvian cuisine have generated more interest and attracted increasing foreign investment in the region. Beyond attracting businesses, the arts attract people, and that constitutes one of the main assets to increase tourism in the region. So once again, welcome to UpNext, Latin America and the Caribbean Creative Industries, and learn more about the possibilities for tomorrow.
At its core, IFC Next Gen is about amplifying and promoting the work that young staff here do at IFC. Next Gen is all about showing who we really are here.
More than 40% of our staff are millennials or Gen Z. So it really gives young people more courage and opportunities to speak up and to solve problems with creative solutions.
IFC Next Gen organized the first ever creative industries event at IFC. We had more than 150,000 people watching our replays and just a lot of engagement among creatives who were very excited to share their work and to show that it has its place in development as well.
It's been so exciting connecting with creatives from all around the world. As a young staff here at IFC, they really empower you. As you can see, we're co-leading and pushing this new creative industries event. They give us a lot of space to work, and then I meet a ton of talented, creative people from all around the world.
We started by focusing on Africa and have expanded this to Latin America and the Caribbean. As a young staff, I think IFC really allows us the opportunity to grow expertise in an area and then expand this to different sectors and geographies.
IFC and the World Bank Group are as diverse as the world itself. Every day you're challenged to think outside the box, you gain global perspectives, and IFC is a change maker, and I'm part of the change.
And
Andrea, é um prazer receber você no nosso painel do evento sobre eventos de indústrias criativas aqui no Brasil. O que é a economia criativa e como ela se revela no Brasil?
A economia criativa é um termo controverso, porque não existe uma definição formal, ou seja, várias instituições diferentes, governos diferentes, encaram a economia criativa de uma forma diferente. O tema comum é todas as indústrias que constroem em cima do que a gente chama de criatividade e que, de alguma forma, geram propriedade intelectual. E aqui no Brasil, existe um entendimento, talvez equivocado, de que economia criativa sejam apenas as artes, ou seja, cinema, música, museus. Mas economia criativa, ela tem um leque gigantesco de atividades. Algumas, inclusive, que são fundamentais para a estratégia do país, como tecnologia da informação, TI. E é justamente por isso que se torna importante que se abra uma discussão sobre o assunto, porque como é que você faz políticas públicas para empresas diferentes, né, tão diferentes umas das outras? E é justamente essa questão que nós temos um pouquinho aqui no Brasil, onde existe uma associação entre as artes e não necessariamente a economia criativa como a base da criatividade.
Eu queria saber se você consegue ver alguma tendência para as indústrias criativas no Brasil.
O que, que eu acho que é o interessante? É a percepção dos governos de que você tem que desenvolver essas competências de duas formas, naturalmente qualificando dentro das escolas, mas também criando as condições econômicas para empresas virem para cá e quererem investir na economia brasileira. Isso é uma coisa que não se fala muito, fala-se melhorar a economia de uma forma genérica, mas eu entendo que você viabilizar as condições para que as pessoas queiram investir nos países é fundamental. Então, e economia criativa, por definição, ela é transnacional.
Como é que a sua história, na sua carreira, está relacionada com as indústrias criativas?
Comecei a minha carreira profissional em 1979, como publicitário, trabalhando na área de promoções, promoções, marketing, promoções, dentro desse, enfim, dessa empresa, dentro desse segmento, eu, em 1984, 85, me tornei coordenador geral do Rock in Rio, que foi o primeiro grande festival de música que aconteceu aqui no Brasil. Final de 2004, quando houve a compra da BMG pela Sony, então eu saí e criei a Plan Music, empresa que produziu, entre outros, grande show do Rolling Stones na Praia de Copacabana para 1,5 milhão de pessoas. Fizemos também turnês com U2, Beyoncé. E ano passado criei a UpNext Entretenimento, que é uma empresa hoje que atua praticamente assim, no 360 da música, né, na cadeia produtiva da música. Somos uma pequena gravadora, editora, empresariamos artistas e promovemos eventos de entretenimento ao vivo, como agora o Festival Mita, que vai acontecer agora aqui no Rio de Janeiro, em São Paulo. Enfim, então meu envolvimento com a indústria criativa, com a cadeia produtiva da música é total desde 1984. Porque esse mercado tem uma tendência de crescimento muito grande nos próximos anos, vai continuar crescendo. Ano passado, esse mercado no Brasil cresceu em termos de 20% em música gravada através do streaming. E evidentemente que isso tem um reflexo no entretenimento ao vivo, que é a área que eu, digamos assim, mais me identifico, mais me dedico. A América Latina faz parte de um calendário, né, de um calendário mundial, de um calendário internacional, onde os artistas fazem questão de vir aqui. Se tornou um mercado importante, sob o ponto de vista de faturamento, sob o ponto de vista de público, sob o ponto de vista de marketing, sob o ponto de vista de, enfim, de desenvolvimento de carreiras. Então, assim, acho que a tendência do nosso negócio é, sem dúvida, uma tendência de crescimento e inovação.
Oi, Duda, é um prazer te receber aqui no nosso evento. Muito obrigada pela sua participação.
Obrigado, Ana. Bom dia, boa tarde, boa noite. Muito obrigado ao IFC e IFC pelo convite de estar aqui. É uma honra para a gente, para mim pessoalmente, representar a Dream Factory em uma mesa, um painel super interessante com o meu querido amigo Luiz Oscar Niemeyer, com a Andrea Loffler. Então, muito obrigado, Ana. Eu tenho 43 anos, decidi trabalhar com entretenimento ao vivo aos 18. Estou, portanto, há 25 anos nesse mercado. E a razão de eu ter escolhido trabalhar com entretenimento ao vivo é basicamente pelo produto daquilo que a gente faz, que é emocionar as pessoas. Então, isso é a essência do entretenimento ao vivo. De novo, seja ele esportivo, seja musical, seja artístico, qualquer que seja o ângulo do entretenimento ao vivo. Então, a gente realmente acredita e vivencia e coloca diariamente esse pensamento em prática aqui no Rio de Janeiro.
Na América Latina como um todo, existem problemas de desenvolvimento. E dois deles são bastante importantes e que o Brasil com certeza sofre também. Um é a questão da baixa escolaridade e a segunda é a questão do trabalho informal. Eu queria saber se você acha que esses dois elementos, eles ajudam ou atrapalham no desenvolvimento da economia criativa?
Vejo justamente o entretenimento ao vivo como uma grande oportunidade para essa grande parcela que tem uma formação acadêmica, né, uma formação escolar básica ou muitas vezes nenhuma, mas que é o trabalho técnico, efetivamente. O setor de entretenimento ao vivo, ele é um setor que absorve esta mão de obra em várias etapas da sua cadeia produtiva. Né? A gente tem, estamos falando de carregadores, de montadores, de cenógrafos, de eletricistas, de seguranças, de profissionais de limpeza, né? De buffet, né? De garçons. Então, ele tem uma capacidade de absorver essa mão de obra muito fortemente. E razão pela qual a gente advoga, a gente defende muito a criação, e isso não serve apenas para Rio de Janeiro, Brasil. O Rock in Rio, mesma abordagem, dois terços, um pouco menos de dois terços dos ingressos vendidos para o Rock in Rio, são 700 mil ingressos, são para consumidores, são para o público de fora do Rio de Janeiro. Ora, é o entretenimento ao vivo gerando demanda para o hotel, para o transporte, para o bar, para o restaurante, para o ponto turístico.
Tudo é excelente. Muito obrigada. Atizou muito bem a questão de como a economia criativa ela pode gerar um impacto social, né? Muito além do impacto sobre a geração de emprego, mas da sociedade como um todo, né?
Há uns anos atrás, no Brasil, você praticamente não via ser feita uma discussão que relacionava carnaval e assédio. Né? Em 2016, foi realizada uma pesquisa e aí o resultado da pesquisa em geral, né, dizia o seguinte, que a maioria dos homens no Brasil achava que se você estava na rua no carnaval, você não podia reclamar de ser assediado. Uma certa confusão assim, entre o que é espaço público e corpo público. Porque não é porque eu tô com meu corpo num espaço que é público, meu corpo continua sendo privado. Né? Eu não estou autorizando ninguém a me tocar ou fazer nada comigo se não tem ali um consentimento expresso. Então eu acho que o Mulheres Rodadas, junto de outros grupos que vieram aí na esteira no carnaval, nós certamente ajudamos assim a pautar essa discussão de uma maneira muito eficaz, tá? Isso passou a ser mais debatido. As mulheres, elas são maioria nos blocos de carnaval, mas elas não são as professoras. Elas não são quem está na direção desses blocos, entendeu? A liderança ainda é muito masculina, né? Essas questões de gênero, elas deveriam ser um problema do carnaval. Elas não deveriam ser um problema dos blocos feministas, entende? Que estão no carnaval. Deveria ser um problema de todo mundo. Eu acho que a gente está no carnaval para produzir essa imagem, entendeu? Do que é possível se fazer num universo onde as mulheres estão na rua e não temem pelos seus corpos, aonde as mulheres estão liderando um projeto, aonde as mulheres estão usando o carnaval como meio para pautar discussões políticas. A ONU apoiou a gente em diversas dessas iniciativas, ou que a gente estava liderando, campanha para combate do assédio, contra o assédio no carnaval, ou campanhas, às vezes, que eram puxadas por parceiros e parceiras nossas que a gente estava participando e que a ONU também estava junto. Mas eu acho que a gente transforma-se em realidade um mundo que a gente quer que exista, sabe? Ele ainda não existe, né? É um mundo que a gente sonha, mas naqueles instantes que a gente está junto na rua ali, ele é de verdade.
Maravilha, não teria como enterrar a sua participação de uma melhor forma. Muito obrigada pela sua participação.
Bill Sonneborn, the Senior Director for Disruptive Technology and Funds at IFC. And I'm really excited about the creative industries and the launch since November when we focused on Africa. My father is an artist, and no matter how much I tried to teach him about coding in Python or data science, he just doesn't get it. It's now time for IFC and the World Bank Group to actually celebrate and recognize and find development opportunities for creatives. And so in November, we launched our first ever UpNext event focused on the creative industry in Africa. And now we're celebrating the Latin America and Caribbean. And we can't be more excited for the focus, the development that's happened within IFC since that period in November. We formed a cross-sectoral working group involving every aspect of IFC. We focused on six primary areas of focus in this cross-sectoral work. One is film or video. The second is music. The third is fashion. The fourth is creator tech, thinking about how technology intersects within each of these segments. Finally, visual arts and culinary arts. And so this cross-sectoral working group is involving all of IFC. Let me give you an example. Disruptive technologies, of which I have responsibility, is focused on the intersection of creative industries and technology. How artists can better monetize their content, what they create, across all six facets that we talked about, to reach global audiences, better control and protect their intellectual property. Our financial institutions colleagues are focused on how to finance against that IP, thinking about ways that we can de-risk banks in our markets, the 100 countries we focus on in emerging markets, to get them more interested in lending into the creative industry. Using technology like pre-sales, working with our colleagues at the World Bank to improve intellectual property rights in our countries of operation, bringing that all together to improve the financeability and bankability of creators to reach markets. Our manufacturing team is focused on the intersection of the fashion value chain. So take West Africa as an example, or even Latin America, which is how do designers come up with content, really interesting designs, and then think about how the whole production and scalability of that fashion line reaches global markets. So, and finally, this exploration, the focus on kind of the areas our cross-sector working group is doing and what we're trying to actually invest in and develop is gonna take some time. It's not simple. It's a new area for IFC, but I'm confident we're gonna figure it out. And you're gonna hear about some really unique and interesting things in the near future. Thank you. Enjoy the show. Really excited about UpNext Latin America and the Caribbean.
As you just heard from Bill, now is the time for investors to participate in developing the creative industries in emerging markets. At IFC, we're working to work with international partners as they seek opportunities and navigate the risks in this area. For example, IFC is an investor in Monashi's fund, which invests in Indaband, a Brazilian platform of social and musical collaboration which has made inroads in that market. Next up, we will have Daniel Murta, the CEO and co-founder of Indaband, to tell us about his next plans for the app and why it's important to invest in creative industries.
I think that my history with startup goes back to 2008, actually. Back then, some friends and I, we founded this company called Shoes Brazil, which is basically a search engine for deep web. And eventually it became the largest law and government hub in Brazil. Actually, you can say in the world in terms of traffic. And we tend to favor musicians when we're hiring simply because we believe they make good programmers, right? So we ended up with this very musical group and very festive culture, I would say. So then the pandemic came, we locked down. Working remote was not a problem. At that point, we had already been a hybrid company for, I don't know, like 10 years or something like that. But we really missed our musical happy hours, you know? So that's how Indaband kind of came along. We felt that many people like us would enjoy a place to connect through music, basically. Okay, so Indaband is like, you can think of it as a social plus music collaboration and co-creation platform. We want people to have a place to make and celebrate music, basically. So from a technical point of view, Indaband is a social network built on top of this Keep It Simple studio, where people can easily record their musical videos, invite friends to collaborate with, and to find a, I would say, an open source music collaboration environment, right? In our particular case, I think that the major thing was our track record, basically. So, I mean, all founders have had previous success stories before, and we have worked together before. A good team is a very major risk downer. So we kind of made clear from the beginning, we want to be this group of users of our own product. And this means we want teammates that are music hobbyists or enthusiasts, and that apply to our investors as well. So we are this group of our users of the product we're trying to solve. I kind of see the creator economy as sort of a new era, you know, like enabling people to make a living from their passions is much more than economics, right? I mean, it's about giving people's lives more meaning. It's about redefining some words like work or job for the next generation. So it's pretty a huge thing. The call would go like, let's try to make it happen faster and faster, you know? So, and investors, they have a reach, a huge way of helping here, you know? So yeah, the call would be, let's make it happen sooner, you know?
How did I get into this fashion business? I was literally born into it. My mother was one of Trinidad's leading dressmakers, so my favorite playground was her sewing room. So that's where I lived my trade. I started right there. I loved what she did, and I was inspired from a very early age as I spent my time with all the magazines and fabrics and buttons and threads and the whirring of machines. So I knew at a very early age that this is the path I wanted to follow. How do I impact communities by being a fashion designer? Actually, this is a part of my job that I really love, and I hope it will be part of my legacy. I mentor a lot of emerging designers coming out from UTT, and also other creatives. A lot of creatives come to my studios to be mentored. Sometimes to be fashion designers, sometimes they go into other areas of the creative industries, but this, I really enjoy doing this. My proudest accomplishment is that after 40 plus years, I'm sitting here speaking about what I do, still being relevant and still creating in the region and abroad and internationally. What challenges do we face in the Caribbean? I could really only speak about the Caribbean, not about Latin America, because I find that a lot of the designers, emerging designers coming out of school, don't have ateliers like mine. They don't have manufacturing capabilities, they cannot do it themselves. So if we could find a hub, and I believe that the UTC school has one now, that designers can take their garments to be made at one, and not only for Trinidad, but just from the Caribbean. If there was one hub in the Caribbean, like China supports, manufacturers for the world. If we could find somewhere in the Caribbean a manufacturing hub that all the designers could send their stuff to, I think that would be a great plus for us. And the fashion industry is always looking for investments, and I think corporations could probably, one, by helping with this hub and education, and also finding, you know, designers design collections, and it's how do we get them out there? How do we get them on the world stage, as it were? So if we could find proper agents or strategists, recently I found one that has really worked for me to get what we are doing to international standard and marketed for us. I think this would be, you know, to be in a trade show, it's quite expensive. Trade shows are not easy. So if we can get some assistance in having a presence there and even showing as a group, as a Caribbean group, I think this would be a tremendous help to us. What next for me? I never stop going. Right now I'm designing my first collection for Resort 23. So I am at my drawing board now, because I show at a resort show in July. So I'm very busy. This is what I'm doing now, designing my second collection, my second resort collection that will be shown internationally.
Una mujer super luchadora, motivada, apasionada con lo que hace. que es para mí es una bendición el sentir que estoy haciendo algo que me gusta. Bueno, te puedo decir con muchísimo orgullo que uno de los logros para mí ha sido crear un modelo de negocio de sustentabilidad. ¿Por qué? Porque esto ha sido cómo nosotros podemos integrar y cómo nosotros, mediante nuestro recurso y de nuestra industria, podemos hacer un modelo de negocio en donde podamos resolver una problemática que existe en estas comunidades indígenas, que son comunidades que con este modelo de negocio las integramos a que sean ellas partes de este proyecto. Ellas están bajo un sistema que se llama de sociedad de solidaridad social, en donde ellas pasan a ser partes socias de la empresa, teniendo ellas legalidad jurídica. Y para mí, pues eso es un gran logro, porque no nada más es cómo colaboramos con el artesano, sino cómo lo integramos, cómo lo dignificamos y al mismo tiempo cómo le damos la equidad y la igualdad en que estén en un proyecto en donde ellas son partes socias y aparte que también ellas ponen todo su corazón en que este proyecto sea una realidad y sea una misión de vida. Para mí, una limitante muy grande, el apoyo financiero. Por ejemplo, yo estoy invitada a New York Fashion Week de París, de Nueva York, de Italia, y quiero ir a todos. La verdad es que quiero ir a todos. Si nosotros tuviéramos una plataforma donde hubiera un apoyo para todos los diseñadores latinoamericanos y del Caribe, en donde nosotros pudiéramos despegar para poder competir, porque tenemos todo para competir, tenemos una historia, tenemos un legado, tenemos una cultura muy rica, tenemos calidad, tenemos todo el corazón puesto en lo que hacemos. Si nosotros tuviéramos una plataforma mucho más sólida financieramente para competir, nosotros ya estaríamos en todas partes del mundo. Y hacia allá vamos.
Gastronomy is part of the creative industries, even though it's not the first thing that we think about. It's especially interconnected to so many other areas like agribusiness, food security, employment, tourism, and even cultural preservation. This is especially a big deal in Latin America, where food is a big thing for the daily life. In 2020, 7 Latin American restaurants made the list of the world's top 50 best.
Yes, the Latin American and Caribbean region account for around 14% of the world's global food production. Although the pandemic took a hard toll on the industry's employment level as well as their imports. So today, to take a deep dive into gastronomy, we're going to talk with a chef from Bolivia and Peru, including the top female chef from 2021.
Wow, okay, I can't wait.
Mucho disfrutar de una buena mesa, de cocinar, entonces creo que desde muy chica tuve esta pasión, este gusto. Terminé el colegio y automáticamente decidí estudiar cocina aquí en Lima, así que creo que desde siempre, quise ser cocinera.
¿Qué platos te parece que reflejan mejor esta gran diversidad de culturas, productos que tenemos en el Perú?
Definitivamente aquí en Perú somos muy afortunados, porque tenemos una biodiversidad gigante, una cantidad de microclimas, ecosistemas, de suelos. Entonces, por ende, tenemos muchos productos y muchos platos. Entonces, creo que uno de ellos podría ser el ceviche. Definitivamente es un plato que está ya en todo el mundo. Creo que representa nuestro cariño, nuestra pasión por el mar. También refleja pues, la unión de distintas culturas. Entonces, creo que el ceviche es un plato muy, muy representativo. Pero también me gusta siempre mencionar otro plato o preparación de los Andes, de la Sierra del Perú, que se llama huatia. Creo que es el mejor ejemplo de la conexión entre las personas y el suelo y la tierra, ¿no? El hecho de consumir las papas en el mismo lugar donde han sido sembradas y luego cosechadas, creo que es un ejemplo muy bonito y un plato que creo que nos representa mucho a nosotros.
¿De qué logro te sientes más orgullosa?
¿De qué logro me siento orgullosa? Creo que definitivamente de los tres conceptos o espacios que hemos podido crear, Central, COI en Lima y Mil en Cusco, creo que son conceptos que soñamos y siempre quisimos tener. Y creo que lo hemos podido lograr. Y por supuesto, se ha podido hacer esto con un gran equipo humano. Creo que ese es un punto importante para mencionar. Es algo en lo cual yo me pongo muy, muy contenta y muy orgullosa porque hemos podido crear este grupo de personas que comparten la misma pasión, la misma filosofía, que nos acompañan en el mismo camino. Entonces creo que eso es lo más importante porque para poder crear pues necesitamos, ¿no?, de un equipo de personas, si no sería imposible. Entonces creo que eso es lo más bonito y con lo que más contenta yo me siento.
En este contexto difícil de la pandemia, ¿qué retos ha enfrentado la gastronomía?
Creo que no solo a la gastronomía, sino a todos nos ha golpeado muy, muy fuerte, ha sido muy duro. En la gastronomía, por supuesto que también. Fue algo nuevo, mucha incertidumbre. En nuestro caso, teníamos muchas personas, casi 100 personas, esperando pues a ver qué sucedía. Entonces sí, una época todavía continúa, pero va mejorando, pero una época pues muy, muy complicada, ¿no? Han aparecido muchos nuevos emprendimientos, muchos nuevos negocios, restaurantes chicos, grandes. Entonces creo que por cualquier lado hay que sacar algo positivo y definitivamente sí, hemos aprendido mucho.
¿Cuáles ves que son los mayores retos para los chefs en Latinoamérica?
Queda mucho trabajo, educación, nutrición sobre todo. Creo que nosotros los cocineros tenemos esta ventaja de estar muy conectados a los productores, al campo. Entonces, definitivamente existen muchos puntos y muchas áreas las cuales se podrían mejorar para tener mejores resultados, ¿no? Métodos de trabajo, la educación, como te mencionaba, creo que es muy importante y nos falta mejorar mucho. Desde muy chiquitos hay que enseñar. También está la parte de la ciencia, maquinaria, que nos podría también ser muy útil para los campos, para reducir tiempos de trabajo, estudios de semillas, de tubérculos, de raíces. Creo que hay bastante por hacer, ¿no? Entonces, definitivamente sí, sería muy positivo y sería genial poder concretar algo, ¿no?
Para a un aspirante a chef, alguien que recién esté comenzando, ¿qué consejos tendrías?
Hay que trabajar mucho, hay que tener mucha paciencia, hay que saber escuchar porque de todo se aprende. Entonces, mi consejo es ese, ¿no? Estar seguro realmente es que esto es lo que tú quieres. Esta carrera es muy gratificante, te da cosas muy positivas. El hecho de conocer no solo tu país, sino el mundo, conociendo distintas culturas, distintas personas, productos. Entonces, creo que es muy gratificante finalmente y uno aprende en el camino a disfrutarla, ¿no? Que es lo más lindo. Entonces, ese es mi consejo.
Don Perú es la institución del Estado encargada de promover el turismo, las exportaciones y las inversiones del país. Es una institución pública y dentro de las estrategias que utiliza para la promoción de turismo y de los productos exportables, tiene la gastronomía como uno de sus objetivos de promoción, ya que nos permite no solamente promocionar la imagen del país y también el turismo gastronómico, sino también los productos que tenemos de exportación, ¿no? Nosotros decimos, por ejemplo, el Perú es un país que tiene diversidad en productos, que tiene una comida variada, que se basa en sus productos de las distintas regiones, pero si no tenemos a ese empresario que promueve el producto y que finalmente lleva el producto al mercado en donde estamos participando, no estarías completa nuestra comunicación. Entonces, sí se han desarrollado estrategias que han permitido vincular nuestra gastronomía con el sector de la agroexportación e inclusive con los servicios y también con franquicias que también están a cargo de la promoción de PROM Perú. Y para nosotros ha sido exitoso el trabajo que hemos hecho en la medida que ha habido adhesión del sector privado y esto también ha conllevado a un aumento progresivo de nuestras agroexportaciones, ¿no? Vemos también cómo en la pandemia se originaron una serie de movimientos que permitieron subsistir al sector gastronómico en particular, ¿no? el delivery fue uno de ellos y el dark kitchen que se comenzó a desarrollar en la ciudad de Lima, sobre todo principalmente, fue una manera de salvar, y esto es a iniciativa de los privados, ¿no? Los privados tuvieron ese empuje. Cuando me refiero a los privados, son los emprendedores de restaurantes y que tuvieron esa iniciativa de decir, no me voy a quedar con los brazos cruzados, voy a ver qué otras formas tengo para llegar a mis comensales. Venimos trabajando proyectos con otras instituciones, como por ejemplo el Indecopi, para ver cómo revalorizamos algunos productos, cómo podemos darle un poco de valor a algunos productos que son oriundos del Perú y que sabemos que con esta revalorización van a tener un uso más continuo en nuestra cocina peruana, que no se pierdan, y también un valor para la gente que lo quiere consumir, que lo vea, lo vincule con el Perú, que lo vea como algo peruano, que lo vea como algo que tiene un valor diferencial, ¿no? Entonces venimos trabajando en algunos proyectos que seguro vamos a anunciar en los próximos meses.
No tengo una historia, digamos que muy romántica con la cocina. Nunca había realmente planificado de tener la carrera de gastronomía como un futuro de vida. Todavía no había muchas escuelas de gastronomía, es más, solo había una, que era cerca de mi casa. Y bueno, era una época donde las carreras técnicas y alternativas estaban un poco surgiendo, ya que todo el sector de profesionales estaba, digamos que un poco saturado. Entonces decidí estudiar la carrera de gastronomía. Ya son 15 años de carrera dentro de la cocina.
¿Dónde están algunos de los mayores desafíos para los chefs latinoamericanos?
Bueno, creo que Latinoamérica es un caso muy particular porque en estos últimos 10 años el mundo ha puesto muchísimo foco en Latinoamérica. Yo siempre he dicho que es como un monstruo dormido que bueno, finalmente está despertando, y que durante estos últimos años creo que muchísimos cocineros hemos podido reflejar un poco de nuestra cultura y nuestra diversidad. Creo que estamos yendo por un buen camino. Creo que Latinoamérica va a ser un punto turístico muy grande en estos próximos años. La verdad es de que nosotros pensábamos de que el turismo se iba a reactivar el próximo año, pero ahora podemos decir que un 60% de nuestros comensales ahora mismo son turistas. Entonces esto está despertando y reactivándose mucho, mucho más antes de lo esperado, lo cual es súper positivo. Creo que eso puede ser un beneficio, por supuesto, muy grande a nivel turismo, reputación del extranjero, promoción al país, salud, educación, etcétera, ¿no? Y nada, esperemos ver mucho, mucho más apoyo del sector privado, que yo sí pienso que gracias al sector privado hemos podido construir lo que hemos construido hasta ahora, por lo menos en la escena gastronómica nacional, ¿no? De Bolivia hablando particularmente.
Video games are a multi-billion dollar industry in Latin America, with an estimated 110 million gamers in the region. With the rise of the metaverse, we see that VR, gaming and animation are giving path to a brand new world.
Yes, and with the right investments, the LAC region has the opportunity not only to showcase their cultural heritage through e-tourism, but also create new jobs and career paths. So, for more insights on this industry, we'll speak with 6 experts from across the region.
Contratamos? Por que nós não capacitamos e passamos a contratar jovens aqui do Rio de Janeiro, da Bahia, de São Paulo, das favelas? Por que nós não fazemos isso? Esse é o objetivo do AfroGames, é jogar essa ideia para que a gente possa capacitar jovens, e é muito rápido, é 2-3 anos, você já tem um programador júnior com um salário de 3-4 mil reais. Em 2019, a gente conseguiu botar o projeto AfroReg em pé. Nós começamos a capacitar 100 jovens dentro da favela de Vigário Geral com tudo de ponta, computador, cadeiras, internet, ar-condicionado, professor, lanche, tudo. Nós capacitamos, começamos a capacitar 100 jovens em jogos, League of Legends, Fortnite, em trilha sonora, em parte de música, trilha sonora, produção de trilha sonora para games e programação de jogos.
Meu nome é Dani Monroy, sou fundador da empresa Ultraludic, que é um pequeno startup, onde criamos proyectos basados en entretenimiento. Yo soy diseñador gráfico, me gusta mucho el tema de interacción y con los años prácticamente quise dedicarme a eso. En mi país pues no existía el tema de desarrollo de videojuegos y en el camino fui aprendiendo a hacerlos por mi cuenta hasta que un año, hace como 7 años atrás, decidí empezar mi primer proyecto de un videojuego con Mayan Pits, que es un juego sobre el juego de pelota maya, y lo que buscaba era promover la cultura a través del juego de pelota. Un poco de historia antes de contarte eso. O sea, realmente, digamos, la iniciativa de este proyecto era poder hacer algo que mostrara un poco de la cultura de nuestro país. En este caso yo traté de vincularlo con los mayas y algo que fuera entretenido. Entonces, el juego de pelota, que es en lo que se basa el juego, tomamos de base la historia, un fragmento del Popol Vuh, donde los hermanos Hunahpush, Palenque, bajan al inframundo para luchar en esta batalla del bien y el mal. Y realmente el juego busca dejar esa pequeña historia para recordarla y promover los lugares que existen físicamente.
3DAR. 3DAR es una empresa que nace en 2004 con la intención de hacer 3D, de hacer algo digital, algo relacionado con los juegos. Nació más como de un espíritu emprendedor y de juntar gente afín para poder trabajar en lo que nos gusta o con independencia y libertad. Primero hicimos render fotorrealistas, después hicimos animación de personajes, evolucionamos a hacer VFX para películas, con personajes también integrados, después empezamos a meternos con lo que es projection mapping, de ahí pasamos a realidad aumentada, realidad virtual, tecnologías mixtas, realidad mixta, juegos.
Quería hablar para el sector privado que investir hoje em tecnologia nas favelas, em bairros pobres, no jovem, não é caridade, é investimento. É uma mão de obra que você vai gerar e um consumidor que você vai trazer para a tua marca. Então, são consumidores fiéis, são consumidores que necessitam de produtos específicos e que querem consumir. E a gente só precisa fazer essa ligação entre a tecnología y el joven de la favela.
Las instituciones internacionales definitivamente juegan un papel importante porque le dan exposición a los emprendedores, a los que tienen esas ideas y logran vincularlos, porque a veces tal vez en el país donde uno está desarrollando no tiene las oportunidades o las conexiones necesarias, y las instituciones internacionales pueden hacer ese vínculo para poder exponer el trabajo de estos emprendedores y darlos a conocer y lograr a través de eso otros vínculos o otros negocios y hacer nuevos proyectos. Entonces yo sí creo que es importante el involucramiento de instituciones internacionales para apoyar a la industria creativa.
Antes una cámara para filmar salía miles de dólares, ahora todos tenemos una cámara y así por delante, o sea, es una tendencia generalizada. Entonces, ahí el tema es como, bueno, que llegue lo básico, digamos, que llegue internet, que llegue capacitación mínima. Yo creo que lo principal que puede llegar a ser un cambio diametral es en el sistema de educación, que en la mayoría de los lugares sigue siendo muy arcaico y muy lineal. Mi visión de la educación es que debería ser mucho más eficiente, mucho más direccionada a objetivos y mucho más estructurada digitalmente, mucho más medida con inteligencia artificial. Entonces, en la medida que se pueda hacer algo en donde los costos educativos no sean tan pesados y la gente pueda capacitarse por tutoriales con una pequeña asesoría. Ahí, de repente, cuando la gente tiene la oportunidad de desarrollar sus talentos, ahí automáticamente ellos salen a competir después porque les entusiasma, porque les gusta. Entonces, son ese primer envión que es la educación que...
My name is Camille Salvon Abrahams. I am the project lead for Tap Factory and head of animation at the University of Trinidad and Tobago. So in Trinidad and Tobago and the Caribbean, this industry is relatively new, but it's very exciting because it's in the schools. In University of Trinidad and Tobago, for instance, we start with a diploma. Now we have a BFA in digital media arts. And of course we have the Tap Factory, which is a support system to put our students to work. So it took a little while for us to get there, but because this is young people's language, digital media, you'd find that it will, you know, it will grow, and it's showing signs that it's something that definitely we will embrace as a region. When I completed my education at Goldsmiths University, I wanted to come back to the Caribbean. That was my main thing. And winning the award, this prestigious award in London, I felt that, okay, I could come back and make a difference. But coming back to the Caribbean, where there isn't a history of animation, was one of the most challenging things that I faced coming back. So what I did, I thought about the concept of the festival so as to create awareness, also to create content, and just to create platforms for persons coming, you know, behind me, those who would take on those challenges. So the purpose really is for that. The purpose is to, one, make animation and digital media become a common thing in the Caribbean, and also to be able to create content, because it is so important that we create Caribbean content for the global stage. It's very, very challenging for women to break into this industry because it is a male-dominated industry. It has been like that from ever since. So therefore, breaking in means that, you know, obviously your support system as far as other female animators, it's not really there. What I think can happen to affect that change is to put more women out there, put women more like myself, of course, and all the other female students that are doing fabulous out there so that other females can see. I work closely with Microsoft, for instance, for Girls in ICT Day. Every year we put on shows, we put on demonstrations, we do workshops, and that way you then become a pillar for others to see that it is possible being a woman in the industry. Animation is one of the best things you could do. A career in digital media on a whole is one of the best career you could have. It is a multi-billion dollar industry. In fact, now they're saying like oil and gas and animation and digital media on the same level, because that is the future. Supporting the creative sector is really, really important. And we think organizations like IFC could do so by policy, you know, implementing policy, and also through financial investment, especially to our own central banks here, because the creative sector on a whole is not really taken seriously as, for instance, bricks and mortar. So by supporting the creative sector, organizations like that could really be a voice, and a voice for change, because we don't normally have access to the kind of investment that other sectors have.
Our creativity as a species is the reason why we've been able to make so many advancements in everything from technology to communication, the way we eat, the way we entertain, have fun, and our quality of lives as human beings. Thus, the investment in our creativity and the creative industries will continue the growth of the development of the species. It's so important for our planet, for us, to invest in our creative industries, to put our resources, our money, our time, and our effort behind those who allow us to dream and dream big. Had we not had the Jetsons, we may not have had cell phones or soon to be flying cars or electric cars. Think about it. Investment, creativity, that combination ensures we win every time.
Thank you for joining IFC UpNext LAC Edition. We hope this has been eye-opening for you and that you will stay in touch with us as we explore the creative industries around the globe. For any feedback or suggestions, you can email upnext@ifc.org, and the replays of this event will be available on all our social media platforms.
I also want to give a huge thank you to the many members of the team who helped put this together. We couldn't have done it without you. If you're connected right now on the Welcome platform, we invite you to stick around and join our networking lounges where you can connect with participants and guests from the event. From beautiful Mexico City, hasta luego.
Hasta luego.
Parce que moi j'aime la vie, pas pour entrer dans mauvaises affaires, même si c'est vrai la vie dit. Moi t'as aimé où l'on belle auto, mais c'est pendant moi beaucoup, beaucoup cap. Ma fait tout ça me connaît pour chauffer au camion de mer. Moi pito, moi pito, pito, pito van lo, pito van lo. Pito marche dans soleil chaud. Pito van lo, pito van lo. Fè edikasyon ti moun yo avan mali. Se pa chak joun ta pran la ria, m'oblije sa ti et la via. Gen de jou m'pa gen kop taksi ya. Pa jom gen tan pou ti moun yo. Lè mwen rentre yo gen tan fè dodo. M'a fè tout sa m'kapab. De mè fòk yo citoyen van la. Mwen pito, mwen pito, pito. Pito van lo, pito van lo. Pito marche nan soleil chaud. Pito van lo, pito van lo. Pou m'fè edikasyon ti moun yo avan yali. Ma prati grans bon Dje, pap jom dekouraje. Mèm si m'kone an pil kout swè gen pou l'tombe. Tout en tête, moins pas coupé, les mains sont chapeau paille. Ma espéré, non. Mounio Mendoa, Mounio Mendoa, Mounio Mendoa, Mounio Mendoa, Maman. Nan la vi nan pwè son metye. Yo nan mbure isi fò pa pelite. Pa jan dene yo ti ke malere se yon viche. Ma pou men mwè ti ke bitit mwen an tinite. Mama mou,